How's everybody today? I'm Rebecca Hagelin, a national co-chair of Women for Cruz. Thank you. And I'm just going to set the stage a little bit of what we're doing here today. When we come to this point in this great country we live in, where we have the awesome opportunity to select our leader and our leaders on many different levels, sometimes it's easy to forget in all of the debates and discussions about policy and personalities that what this really boils down to is what's best for you and for me and for your children as individuals, about how it affects your daily life. It's easy to lose sight of that when people talk about trillions of dollars of debt and when people talk about massive government overreach into every facet of our lives. But as we sit here today and have this wonderful discussion with some very strong and impressive women, I want you to think about how these things affect your lives. I'm a mom. My children are now all grown. But there was a stage in my life where I chose to stay home with my children. My husband and I believed in something that we also called parent-directed education, believing that at every stage of my children's lives, and depending on where we were living, there might be a different educational need that was unique to them. So sometimes we homeschooled, sometimes we had them in public school, sometimes we had them in private school, and sometimes we had a mixture of all three, which means I might have been a little nutsy once in a while. My husband was the professor of math and science, and I was the professor of everything else during those years of homeschooling, which I wouldn't trade for anything in the world. But I also realized that as a stay-at-home mom, you know, there were times where I really had to be creative in how I was going to help bring in the family income. So for the stay-at-home moms out there, I know what it's like. You're trying to do the best for your children, provide the extra support your husband in his career, if that's what your family's chosen to do, and help bring home a little bacon yourself. And then I went into the career field. I actually had different phases of my life in the career field. I spent 6 years as a vice president of the Heritage Foundation in Washington, D.C., working on policy. Thank you. And as an author, I've written two books. The third one is coming out in May. One is Home Invasion, Protecting Your Family in a Culture That's Gone Stark, Raving, Mad. And the one coming out is 30 Ways in 30 Days to Strengthen Your Family. So whatever calling you have in your life, whatever God has directed you to do on each day of your life, as well as a life goal, it's important to know that the government is not going to be in the way. Whether it's in education, whether it's being able to keep more of what you earn from the sweat of your brow through lower taxes, whether it's having fewer regulations so that you can start a home-based business as I did, without fearing the government looking over your shoulder and trying to stop you at every step of the way, or whether it's understanding that you really shouldn't have to get up every day and worry about whether your family is safe, whether there are terrorists in your neighborhood that go unwatched and unchallenged because the government has said it's politically incorrect to track them. Our military has what they call no-go zones overseas. And our wonderful law enforcement officials often get what they call no-go zones here because it's politically incorrect. So as you strive to live your life every day to its fullest, you look for a leader, someone who understands. And as a woman as a mom, as somebody who's had a career and has one now, refound my career after my children were grown, it's important for me to know that there is a person who understands that issues like jobs and freedom and security are important to me as a woman. One of the things I love about Ted Cruz is what he said last night. He believes all issues are women's issues. We're not relegated. We're not relegated to talk about just certain issues and that there's a whole other host of issues that don't affect us that we're not smart enough to talk about. He respects that policy affects all of us. And when I look to this very important nation, where the very character of the country is up for grabs, where the Constitution is teetering on the balance, and where we're going to be selecting a leader who is going to stand up and use his bully pulpit to represent what's best and what's hopeful and what's good and decent about every American, the choice is obvious. And it's the person that I'm going to introduce to you right now and welcome to the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, as we seek today to find out more about the very strong women in Ted Cruz's life, I invite you now to give a warm welcome to the man who really gets it, who understands we're all in this together with dignity and hope and purpose and joy. Help me welcome, please, Ted Cruz.
God bless the great state of Wisconsin. Good morning. I'm thrilled to be with you. Rebecca, thank you for being here and for chairing this event now. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. You know, I'm reminded of several years back when I was running for the Senate initially. It was an early Saturday morning. And I was doing radio interviews about 6 in the morning. And our daughters, Caroline and Catherine, they typically love to run in and jump on the bed and wake us up. And so Caroline comes sprinting into the room. She's 3 or 4 years old at the time. And I'm on the phone doing a radio interview, and Heidi's still in bed. She jumps out of bed. She grabs Caroline, takes her out to the living room, says, "Not now, sweetie. Daddy's doing a radio interview." And Caroline crosses her arms, and she stomps out and she goes, "Politics, politics, politics. It's always politics." That's right. But you know, all of us are here for something a lot more important than politics. We're here because we love our families. We're here because we love our country. And because America right now is in crisis. This event this morning is a celebration of strong women. Now, one of the most frustrating things about the Democratic Party is the Democrats love to pigeonhole women. Put them in a little box. Okay, you have a set of issues that are women's issues, and you can wear that hat, and that's what you're allowed to think about. Well, listen, I have news for the Democratic Party. Women are not a special interest. women are a majority of the United States of America. And every issue is a woman's issue. This campaign, at its core, I believe, is about three issues: jobs, freedom, and security. And women, every bit as much as men, care about jobs, freedom, and security. You look at jobs, you look at the economic stagnation, every one of us, we want to get back to that incredible economic growth that has characterized America from the beginning of this country. We want to get back to an environment where manufacturing jobs are coming into Wisconsin instead of going overseas to China and Mexico. We want to see wages going up again instead of stagnating year after year after year. While the bills go up, wages stay stuck. We want to see young people coming out of school with 2, 3, 4, 5 job opportunities. I think the young people heard that one. Jobs are women's issues and men's issues. They are issues for America. And then there's freedom. The incredible freedom that is in our Bill of Rights that protects every one of us. Free speech, religious liberty, the Second Amendment right to keep and bear arms. You know, one of the most fun things I got to do on the campaign was take my darling wife, Heidi. We were up in New Hampshire at a firing range. Now, Heidi is a California native, but an image that I will always love is a picture of her firing a full auto machine gun with a pink hat that said, "Armed and Beautiful." But protecting the Bill of Rights, protecting life, protecting marriage, protecting our fundamental liberties, all of that is at stake in this election. And those are women's issues, those are men's issues, those are adult issues, those are children's issues. Those are the issues for America. And finally, security. There is not a mom in this country who doesn't worry about the safety of her kids, who doesn't worry about what's going on. When we see protests and riots and we see politicians siding with the criminals over the police officers, we start to wonder, what on earth is going on? When we see radical Islamic terrorists blowing up a Paris Opera House, showing up in San Bernardino at a Christmas party, at an office Christmas party, and murdering Americans. Every one of us worries about the safety and security of our families. And we recognize that what we're doing now, having a president that will not even acknowledge the enemy, that is so captive to political correctness, that his response to every terrorist attack is to give us yet another lecture on Islamophobia. Enough is enough. We need a president who will keep America safe. And so the purpose of this event this morning is I want to take some time to introduce you to three strong women who I admire, who I respect, who I've learned from, who I look up to, who I think exemplify the incredible opportunity that America provides to everyone. So with that, I want to ask Rebecca to come back up and join us. And I want to introduce you to three people. Number one, my mom, Eleanor. and my wife, Heidi Cruz, and Caroline Cruz, and Catherine Cruz, and Carly Fiorina.
Well, you're in for a real treat right now, because we invite you to just listen in on the stories and the thoughts of, as Ted said, three incredibly influential women in his life, and really what they think about what the major issues are facing the country today, and their thoughts about what American policy should be and how it affects their lives. So we invite you to just sit back and enjoy and listen to this conversation. And the subject that's really near and dear to my heart, first and foremost always, is that of family and mothers. And Eleanor, I know that you have a lot of stories that you could share with us about Ted. And we're going to try to get some of those out of you today. But I just wanted to start with this one little thing I have to show you here. When Ted was memorizing the Constitution as a young man and going to law school and Harvard and defending the Constitution, did you ever really think it would come to this? Seriously, let me have your thoughts on that. Your son is portrayed as a constitutional expert, and we know that he has argued before the United States Supreme Court. And when, for instance, he defended the rights of veterans to have a cross on a veterans memorial, defended a lawsuit by the ACLU before the U.S. Supreme Court, when he won that suit for religious liberty, he won it for you, and he won it for me. And so tell us a little bit about the young man that was Ted Cruz when he was studying the Constitution and how this fits into it. Yeah, if you could just put the mic right up,
hold it's
a
real
directional
close.
Mic, right up to your mouth. Yeah.
Is that close enough?
Yep, you might even point it a little bit at yourself. There
oh,
you go.
Okay.
There
okay.
you go. Thank you.
All right, not used to this, so we'll have to try. Well, when he was studying the Constitution, he would spend hours in front of myself and his father reciting it and learning the gestures that went with it. And he was with a group called the Constitutional Corroborators. And it was a wonderful group. The man that ran it was very enthusiastic and very encouraging. And because Ted was so interested in so many different things, this was a great outlet for him in order to keep him out of trouble. This was before the days of the internet, thank heavens. I didn't have to deal with that. So this kept him busy because he was reading all sorts of economic books, and he was memorizing the Constitution and writing it out and going to Rotary clubs and Kiwanis clubs in the morning, and I would drive him early in the morning, which was, I'm not a morning person, and he would give his speech, and the men there would just clap, and they'd be so excited. So it gave him a lot of experience in public speaking, which started him on the road to his debate and future success in front of the Supreme Court.
And as a mother, who will probably be the mother of a president of the United States.
Yes.
What message might you have to moms who right now are just trying to figure out how they feed and nurture the talents of their various children?
I think you have to follow the lead of the child to some extent as to what his gifts are or what her gifts are, and allow them to express themselves and further that. And this is what I tried to do, was let him lead. And I would look around and try to find places where he could fulfill his gifts. And that's what I did.
And Heidi, as a mother of two young girls, tell us a little bit about maybe something that your mother taught you that you try to impart with your own children.
Well, every household is run a little bit differently, and sometimes where you live and your lifestyle impacts a little bit to the activities available. But one thing that was really important for Ted and I when we got married was that I knew that regardless of where we lived or the activities in our life, that we had the same principles, that we were raised both with a very, very strong faith that was active in our homes. Our parents had worship with us. I know Ted's parents did with him as well. We had meals together. We had we knew what our family was about and what we represented. And when I met Ted, I knew that was very, very true of him. Our families were similar in that we both had a very, very strong faith and were Christian and were active in our churches and actively lived out our faith. That's one reason that religious liberty, it's been so interesting to me to see the religious liberty battles around the country. When I grew up, we were free to live our faith without discussion, and I know that was true for Ted, too. Some of the hobbies of our families were very different. Ted's family, politics was urgent because of his father's upbringing and where he came from. My family was not very politically active, but was very given to mission service. And the common bond there was living our lives for others, that we do things on the day-to-day to stay healthy and to stay focused, to do well in school. But the ultimate goal is not to retire to the golf course, but rather to do something that makes this world a better place. And so we're trying to instill that. So we're trying to instill that in our girls, in the activities that we do.
I love what you said about you living your life to help others. I have a very close friend, Cheryl Batchelder. She's actually the CEO of Popeyes, and she's written a book about servant leadership. And it seems to me that's kind of what you're saying, because obviously you've been a leader in your own career and field. And I love the fact that you still have that servant's heart about you. I'm going to come back to your career and your upbringing a little bit. But while we're on the topic of motherhood, Carly, I wanted to ask you. You've had a very different experience than Heidi has. Share with us just a little bit about what you would say to encourage parents who might not be having an ideal situation with children.
Well, I was not able to have children of my own, and so I understand in really personal terms what a precious gift life is, and was so blessed when I met my husband Frank 34 years ago that he brought two little girls with him, Tracy and Lori, who have been a huge blessing in my life. I'm reminded of my own mother who, when she was my Sunday school teacher one year, when I was about 8 years old, and she taught me one Sunday morning in the rest of her class, she said, "What you are is God's gift to you. What you make of yourself is your gift to God." And all of my life, my parents stressed that each of us are gifted by God, all of us have potential, and that the purpose in our life is to find and use our God-given gifts for the benefit of others. And as I went on through my own life, I came to realize that truly everyone is gifted by God. Everyone has potential, no matter where I've been in the world, and I've been all over the world, and people in the most abject and adverse circumstances have enormous potential. And so all the way back to leadership, I think that the highest calling of a leader is to unlock potential in others. And so every good parent is a leader, if they unlock the potential of their children. I also think it means that anyone can lead. All of us can lead. You know, there's that saying, oh, leaders are born. Actually, that's not true. Leaders are made. And a leader's calling is to unlock potential in others.
So, Ted, I have a question for you. I would love to know a moment in your life with your relationship with your mom that really stands out to you.
You know, there were a lot of moments. My mom's been a best friend to me my whole life. My relationship with both my parents is very different. I talk about my dad a lot more. And my dad has always been larger than life. He's always been my hero. In fact, my poor mother, when I started running for office, I'd get up and I'd tell my father's story of being imprisoned in Cuba. And I'd sit down and I hadn't talked about my mom. And my mom would look at me and said, "Did you have a mother?" Were you raised by wolves? But my mom, it was always a very, very different relationship. I mean, we would just talk. We would talk and talk and talk. She would drive me to school every morning and drive me back. And I went, our school was about 40 minutes away a lot of times when I was growing up. So it was a long time in the car, and neither of us are morning people. So normally we'd be late to school, and breakfast would be a bowl of cereal that I'm eating in the car while she's driving me. And she was someone and is someone who I can talk to and talk to about just the problems facing the world. And she's got a heart. I mean, listen, I admire her business career. I mean, she was a pioneer professionally. But my mother loves unconditionally. I mean, the most incredible thing as a kid is that I knew no matter what, there was nothing I could do that would lose my mother's love. There was nothing I could do that would cause my mom not to be standing by my side, supporting me. You know, she mentioned the Constitutional Corroborators, which was the nonprofit group that I got involved with in high school. Twice a week, she would drive an hour across town to a local public library where we would meet and study the Constitution. And she would sit there, she'd sit out in the library and usually bring a book or bring the newspaper and read for a couple hours while we were studying. Then she'd drive me back. And she did that twice a week when we toured around Texas, speaking on the Constitution. My mom jumped in the bus and chaperoned five teenagers traveling the state of Texas somehow. We didn't kill her. But she didn't kill us. But it was always, and you know, we worked things out creatively. I mean, I remember when I became old enough that I was able to drive. And you know, junior, senior year of high school, and I'd go out and I had friends and I'm a late night person, so we'd go out and stay up late. But my mother, when I'd get home, I was coming in late and she'd still be up. And I'd be like, "Mom, why are you up?" She said, "I can't sleep if you're out." And so we worked a compromise. It was actually her suggestion. She would go to sleep in my bed.
Wow.
So that I had to wake her up when I got home. And it worked out very well because she could go to sleep, but she knew in an instant if I was home or not, because if she was still in my bed, I wasn't home. And if it got too late, I was getting a phone call.
Wow. That's very creative, which actually brings me back to you. Because I know, just from reading a little bit about you, that you've been a pioneer and creative in a lot of ways. One of them is in your early career path in technology. Tell me a little bit about those early days and this story about refusing to learn how to type.
Well, I got my...
If you just hold that right up to your mouth.
Sorry about that.
No, that's no problem.
I got my degree in math from Rice University, and at that time it was all theoretical math, and that was really before computers were very popular. There were no computer courses.
Just hold it just a little bit closer.
Sorry. Okay. There were no computer courses at that time, so all of the training was on-the-job training. And I was fortunate enough to get a summer job at Shell in their geophysical department, and worked with a young man who was there as an intern also. And we made a game out of seeing how many things we could do and how fast we could work. So we made a good reputation. And my boss recommended me to the head of the computer department at Shell Research Lab. And fortunately, the man hired me and became my mentor and taught me all about computer programming on the job. And I just kind of fell into it. It was great. Hard work does produce good luck sometimes.
That's right.
There's one thing that Ted said a minute ago that I just want to go back to before we go into the careers a little bit more. He used the phrase unconditional love. And, you know, it's easy when, like I said in my opening remarks, when you're talking about the President of the United States and the First Lady of the United States, to think that people always sit on a pedestal and their lives are perfect and untouched by the troubles of life. Or when you look at an awesome businesswoman like Carly Fiorina, who rose to the very top in the corporate world, it's easy to think that some women just have a path laid for them with no challenges. But we know that's not true, right? We all know that as we're sitting here thinking about our lives, we're thinking about a loved one who might be in some difficult situation, and we're thinking about the safety of our kids if they're at school, or, you know, God forbid that every spring for many decades, the spring and the beauty and the joy of hope is spring has been overshadowed with this big, dark, black cloud called the IRS with tax day looming. And we're going to get to that in a minute. But all these problems that we face and challenges in our family, and going back to the term of unconditional love, Carly, share with us just a little bit about how you dealt with the great challenge in your family life, even as a career woman with your daughter.
Well, we lost our younger daughter, Lori, to the demons of addiction. And she had struggled, as so many people do, too many people do, too many families do, with addictions for many years. Multiple addictions, actually. Which is the most difficult thing. If you're dealing with an addict, alcohol and prescription drugs. And perhaps like many parents, we, I think, were in denial for a while. You know, because she was so normal in every other respect, so high functioning, so talented, so smart, so beautiful. So I think, honestly, we tried to put it away for too long, probably. And then, of course, we worked very hard to try and get her help. And there is nothing more difficult, I think, than to lose a child. But there's also something so tragic about watching someone with so many gifts and so much potential literally disappear in front of your eyes, which is what addictions do. I call them the demons of addiction because it feels as though someone is being possessed by a demon that is taking them away from you. So, of course, it was a very difficult time, and it was a very painful time, and it is a time when unconditional love is necessary and also is tested. My faith and my family saw me through that, which is why I'm so grateful to be a person of strong faith and to have a strong family. But I must also say that I have been so blessed by the kindness of so many strangers. You shared with me your story. You know, when we were standing backstage, she was very generous, you were very generous, to share that you lost your brother to addictions. And one of the things that I found, obviously it's a very difficult thing to talk about. I began to talk about it publicly when I realized that so many other families were going through this tragedy, and that perhaps I could be helpful by being open about ours. But one of the things that impressed me is how many people, strangers really, would come up to me and say, as maybe they gave me a hug as you did, and say, I know what it's like. I've been through this, or my family is going through this. So I've been blessed by the kindness of all those strangers as well.
Heidi, one of the things that we touched on in your earlier remarks was growing up as the daughter of missionaries in Africa. And I kind of want to use that as a little bit of a transition point into when you were growing up in a country like Africa where there was so much need, how did you take those experiences and inculcate them into your life, into understanding what the role is of America as a blessed nation that we are in the world?
Well, thank you for that question, Rebecca. You know, it reminds me of how our kids are so impressionable, and the experiences that they have will impact them for the rest of their life. And even though maybe on the day-to-day, for some of the families here with us today, you may not recognize that just how you live and how you spend your time, them just coming along with you to a meeting or to something that you might be doing in your own adult life will really shape who they are, because they see a lot of things that they wouldn't otherwise see if you left them at home. We are bringing our daughters on the campaign trail, and so many days I see them in the bus and they're on their iPads or they're enjoying, playing with the team, the campaign team, and I just wonder if they're getting everything out of it that I want them to. And late in the evening, Caroline will mention that the number of delegates that Wisconsin has or something like that. And she knows your number. So these things I think are so important. And one of the biggest blessings that my parents gave to my brother Scott and I is that they took us with them everywhere they went. And they are people who practice what they preach. And they were very concerned about the third world and poverty. My father's a dentist, and he could do something very practical to help the people in Africa. And so while they were Christians, they did share Jesus Christ with everyone that they met, they were also doing something to help improve their health in the countries. And so coming back from Africa, the first time we went, I was 4. The second time that we went, I was 6. And I remember growing up wanting to come home and send everything that we had to the kids in Africa that had become our friends. But it as you go through adult life and even through college, and as I chose my profession, I knew that most people in the world do not live like we do. Most of the kids growing up in other countries don't have a nice school bus to ride in. They may not have a warm home to live in. We had a family that helped us in Africa, and they lived in a mud hut, and they wanted to sleep on the ground. That's how they were raised. That was their culture. The little girl that was their daughter didn't have pajamas that had feet in them. And I remember wanting to share all that and growing up knowing that 2/3 of the world does not have almost anything of what we have. Basic food maybe, but almost nothing else. And so while my career has taken me into banking and finance, the only reason I really wanted to go work in business was to go work in the third world. And the reason is you think about why are these countries so far behind? It is because they do not have a system of capitalism where people can borrow money and have an idea to fund that idea and produce a product and take risk and bear the responsibility of that risk. There's no court system that if something goes wrong that they can stand up and ask for justice. And there's no political system that is, at least hopefully, relatively used to be free of corruption. It is so important that we protect those three basic things about our democracy, that we have a capitalist system where people can be a part of it. You know, my brother and I were, when we came back from Africa, my dad had us start a business. We wanted to make some money. And he said, well, why don't you find a product and see if you can sell it? That opportunity as a kid taught us so much. We ran a little bread baking business for 10 years. The opportunity to do that is so critical. We must protect our courts. It's one thing that really has always spoken to me about Ted's career, that one of the brightest minds, in my view, in this country is someone who's made a career out of defending the law and the rights that we have. And so when Ted went to Washington and came home after the first few months and said, our Congress isn't working the way that it's supposed to work. Many, many of the people here who have been elected are not representing the people. There is a real form of corruption growing in this country. And that is one of the main reasons that I really was very quickly on board with him running for the presidency. Ted has not been in the Senate very long. In some ways, it seemed like we should wait until our kids were out of college. It's not an easy time for our family to do this, but you look at the importance of protecting these three things, capitalism, the courts, and our political system. We represent the best that this world has to offer on those three legs, and we must preserve it.
Isn't Heidi Cruz the first lady that we've been waiting for?
Going to embarrass me, Rebecca.
Well, I'm guessing there others are trying to do their best at embarrassing you recently in the news. And it's only just beginning. But you're so gracious. That's one of the things that strikes me about you, is that you just have a real gracious demeanor about you. Intelligent and highly educated and a businesswoman and a mom, and hearing that servant's heart that you have, it's going to be a real honor to have you as First Lady. It really will. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you for saying that.
One of the things that I think the mass media has done a great job of hiding is how poorly women are doing under the Obama administration. And of course, we know that Hillary Clinton is just saying she's going to continue along the same path. 2 million women have slipped into poverty during this administration. Women are more underemployed than men. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And, you know, I was always taught, and when I studied, that economic freedom works for everybody, right? It works for men and women and children and families. That the Constitution protects everybody when it's upheld. And I say, thank God that you guys didn't wait for Ted Cruz to run for president. We really are at a crossroad in this country right now. And my very first presidential election that I got to vote in was 1980. And I got to vote for Ronald Reagan for president. And I wasn't married at the time, so here I've been married, I've had 3 children, I've been a stay-at-home mom, I'm back in my career again, and all these years have passed, and I've been looking and looking and looking and waiting. Who is the Ronald Reagan of our generation? And then when I started studying Ted Cruz, first when he was running for Senate, and then at his record as a senator, it became very clear as he battled the Washington cartel and stood for the Constitution. Ladies and gentlemen, the Ronald Reagan of our generation is Ted Cruz. And to that end, one of the big things that we care about in our lives always are, what is the job market like? How can families do better for their children than they had on their own when moms and dads were growing up? And Carly, I would love for you to just share with us a little bit about why the policies that Ted Cruz advocates for capitalism and economic freedom, as a businesswoman and what you saw as a job creator, why those are so important.
First, I want to go back to something that Ted said earlier, which I think is so important. I agree with it 1,000%. As a woman, I'm insulted when the Democrat Party talks about women's issues. I find it insulting because we aren't a special interest group. We are the majority of the nation. We do care about jobs and national security and education. Every issue is a woman's issue. That's a fact. I also want to say, by way of answering your question, that fortunately, my mother insisted that I take typing lessons. And the reason that was fortunate for me is because, unlike Eleanor, who was so much smarter than me, she got a math degree from Rice University, for heaven's sakes. Wow, I got a degree in medieval history and philosophy, which was fascinating, but made me unemployable, and I hated law school. I quit after less than a semester. I did have the presence of mind to leave before the final exam started. Anyway, so I had to go back to work as a secretary, which is how I put myself through college. Now, why is that relevant? Because I started out the way most Americans start out. I started out in a little business. In my case, I was a secretary. I typed and filed and answered the phones for a 9-person real estate firm. My husband Frank, we've been together 34 years. My husband Frank started out driving a tow truck in a family-owned auto body shop. Now, why is that important? Because it is those little businesses, small businesses, new businesses, family-owned businesses that have always been the engine of economic growth in this nation. And we are crushing them. Small businesses, new businesses, family-owned businesses employ half the people in this country, and they create 2/3 of the new jobs. Now, what is happening? You know, we talk about capitalism, we talk about free markets, but the truth is we don't have very many free markets anymore. What we have is crony capitalism instead, which is why the Washington cartel has to be broken. Many years later, I became its chief executive of Hewlett-Packard, and we turned it into a $90 billion firm. So I can tell you, as a CEO of a $90 billion firm, I could make a 73,000-page tax code work for us. I could hire the lawyers, I could hire the accountants, I could hire the lobbyists, and we did. You see, all that complexity in the tax code, it favors the big company over the small business. It favors the wealthy and the well-connected and the powerful, like Donald Trump, by the way, who is the system. And he will preserve the system because he's taken advantage of the system all his life. So why is Ted Cruz's tax plan so important? Because it's not just about lowering the rates. It's about simplifying. You see, Ted Cruz, the reason being a constitutional conservative is so important to economic opportunity is because conservatives understand that the problem is too much power concentrated in the hands of too few. Too much economic power, too much political power. Power, power, money and power have to be dispersed back where it belongs, in the hands of citizens and small businesses and family business owners. And you start with a tax code. You start by saying we're going to have a simple, flat, fair tax. You're going to send your returns in on a postcard. You're going to he will abolish the IRS. It'll be a tiny little department in the Department of Treasury. Or maybe you send your tax returns in on a smartphone. The simplification is at the core of restoring free markets over crony capitalism, of restoring citizen government over the Washington cartel, and of course all that regulation that's been spewing out of Washington, D.C. under Republicans and Democrats alike. Let us face it, we have become a nation of rules, not a nation of laws, and the rulemakers, who are the rulemakers? They're not elected by anybody. They're not accountable to anyone. They're a bunch of bureaucrats. And those rules are crushing this economy. So when he says he's going to roll all those rules back, that's exactly what has to happen to restore economic growth and jobs. Thank you.
So in all of our lives, jobs, freedom, security, these things that we need leadership on. I think you know when you go to tedcruz.org and read all his policies. And I really encourage you to do that. You know, sometimes that becomes a joke at the debates. Go to my website. But seriously, for all Americans who are making the biggest decision of our political lives in a long time, and for some young people, for the very first time, go to tedcruz.org and read the solutions. And what you will see on every page is a belief that government should be limited and out of your lives. Is the belief that the first calling of the Constitution on government is to do what? Provide for the common defense, to protect us. Is that government should get out of the way so that you can pursue your dreams, start your new businesses, work with your God-given creativity and talents, and realize your full potential without having to worry about the big owner's hand of government smothering you. And I hope today, as I have, that you've drawn encouragement and strength from these wonderful three women here today. I thank you so much for showing us that the modern American woman hasn't lost the heart of the original American woman. And Heidi, I would like for you to make one more comment, and then we're going to ask Ted Cruz to close it out for us. Heidi?
Well, Rebecca, I want to thank you so much for hosting us today. I have been a longtime admirer of yours. And as we wrap this up today, I just wanted to say one thing about Ted. And that is, I want all of the women here in Wisconsin and across this country to know how incredibly supportive Ted, in my view, the future president of our country, has always been of all the women in his life. This is a son who was by his mother's side when she had breast cancer. This is a husband who has suggested that I go for every single promotion that I've ever gotten. It has always been Ted's idea. That I join the team, that I apply for the job, that I run the group. Ted's always been the one, even in difficult times, right after we had our second daughter, who said, "That's okay, we can do this together. We're a partnership. You're on maternity leave, you should go for it anyway. We'll make it work." This is a U.S. senator who takes time out of a schedule that he can to sit with our best friend, a woman who was suffering in surgery in the hospital. This is a nephew who never forgets to call his aunt on her birthday, his Aunt Sonia. I've never met a man who is more thoughtful. And it doesn't always go together that someone is at the podium on the stage leading the leading voice for our values in this country, and behind the scenes is taking a bouquet of flowers to his wife or giving his daughters a hug. And I need you to know why I fell in love with him. It's not because of how smart he is or what I thought he might be someday. It is because of how incredibly thoughtful he is of all the women in his life. And I want you to know as voters that he will be equally thoughtful of you and supportive of your families and putting you first, because he always has.
So Ted, you've probably broken a new record of the first presidential candidate in all of history who's been on a stage and been quiet most of the time. And that is an endearing quality as well, is a president who can listen, who absorbs it all, and then can take it into the formation of policy and how you live your daily life. So we're going to let you talk and close this out for us today.
Well, Rebecca, thank you very much. Thank you for being here, and thank you for moderating this program, and I think you've done a terrific job. I have to say I'm inspired. I really hope that our daughters, Caroline and Catherine, were listening to this program today. I hope that little girls all across Wisconsin and all across the country were listening to this program today. Because I think what we saw for just a brief glimpse, just a brief moment, is the incredible potential that every little girl and every little boy has. I've been blessed my whole life to be surrounded by strong women. This is a slice of them, but, Heidi mentioned my tia Sonia, my father's kid sister, who fought in the counter-revolution against Fidel Castro and who was imprisoned and tortured in Cuba. And actually, on that side of the family, I am the shy, retiring one. My father is me amped up to 10. And my tia Sonia is my father amped up to 20. And I do hope Caroline and Catherine and little girls had the opportunity to see that there is nothing you cannot accomplish. There is nothing that is beyond your reach, that you have been given the gift, the extraordinary gift of living in the United States of America, living in a land where people can start with nothing and achieve anything. Where you can start off working as a secretary and rise to become CEO of the largest technology company in the world. You can start off in a working class family in Wilmington, Delaware, where my mom's mom, she was the second youngest of 17 kids. Actually, last year when I was writing a book, I spent some time asking my mom about her family. I discovered actually that the family, it's Irish and Italian. She had a couple of uncles who ran the numbers. And I guess it was your grandmother, am I getting this right, your grandmother that would carry the numbers, which for younger people, these are bookies, these are, gambling, this is the mob. But she... like the lottery. My mother does the sort of not really like the lottery, but it, but that's. But my mom's grandmother used to carry the numbers in a soup pot. She would have a soup pot and then a bigger one, and they'd be nested. And in, so they'd have soup in the soup pot. And all the numbers would be in between the two pots. So, you know, it'd be this, you know, little lady walking down the street carrying the numbers for the mobsters. And yet she stood up. And her dad, my grandfather, was a very difficult man. He did not support the idea of his daughter going to college at all. No one in the family had ever gone to college, and he didn't think women had any business being educated. And my mom, by the way, this is the first time she's ever been on a stage like this. She is not, she does not like this. But she is quiet and she's soft-spoken, but she's got a spine of steel. And she stood up to her dad and became a pioneer in computer science. And then my angel Heidi. Heidi is simply extraordinary. She is... she's my best friend. And that, you know, people say that and that sort of becomes cliche. Heidi and I talk a dozen times a day on everything, on anything. When we got married, one of the reasons we got married, one of the reasons we started dating, our first date, we met January 3rd, 2000. We started dating January 5th. Our first date was a late night dinner that was 4 or 5 hours. It was never ending. And what both of us wanted was a partnership. A partnership of equals who loved each other and did everything together. And I'm amazed every day by you, Heidi. To Caroline and to Catherine and all the little girls and all the little boys, this is what we're fighting for. At the end of the day, it ain't complicated. What we are fighting for is this incredible opportunity that America has given. If you look at the annals of human history, the opportunity for most of history, people were born into their station, and wherever they were born, they would stay there forever. This extraordinary experiment that is America is unprecedented. And we are fighting for this opportunity for the next generation, that every one of us wants to be sure that what enabled these four extraordinary women to lead and accomplish their hopes and dreams, that same opportunity is there for the next generation of extraordinary women, for the next generation of extraordinary men, for the next generation of Americans. And thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That concludes our program.
Sun coming up. City. School bus driver in a traffic jam, staring at the faces in a rearview mirror, looking at the promise of the promised land.